Hey, everybody, we're really happy you're going to be with us tonight because we're sitting down with the fellas from Sk8 Liborius Church in St. Louis. It's seriously one of the dopest places you'll ever hear about. Check it out.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention? Stop what you're doing and listen.
D-O-D-45.
This is the DOD45 Show, drawing over discussions, 45 minutes with a special guest. Welcome. I'm your host and resident artist, Ty of ArtByTai, and with my co-host, Adrienne Taiwali'i, we're having conversations with people who I admire and am inspired by. On this episode, I'll set a 45-minute timer, put my pen to the paper, and we'll learn about our guest through an interview-style discussion. So stay right here with us to experience some laughs and maybe even learn a thing or two. Okay, we're here again. Our guest today's Sk8 Liborius, like you heard in the first. Before we start doing a little, before we discuss that, I don't mean to throw you or put you on the spot, Adrienne, but I want to ask you a question.
Okay.
What would you say that you're really good at?
Nothing.
No, come on.
Walking.
Come on.
No, I am. I'm really good at walking. That's my sport.
Okay, fine. I'll take that. That's the way we're going.
That's the only thing I'm good at.
That's not.
I fall occasionally, but mostly I stay on my feet.
Okay. Well, then, so if someone reached out to you and said they'd like to have you on their show to celebrate how good you were at walking and have you discuss all the things you know about walking, what would your, how would you respond to that? Would you want to do it?
No.
You wouldn't.
I wouldn't do it.
What do you, you're not passionate about anything else? Oh, well, it doesn't matter.
Like gardening, but I'm not good at it.
What would someone like wanted you to be on the show to celebrate your gardening? And
no, I'm not good at it. I can do it.
You wouldn't want to do that either.
Mediocre.
Well, okay.
I wouldn't say I'm good at it, and I'm sorry.
Oh, it's all right.
I'm not good at anything.
I didn't think you were going to say walking.
What do you think I was going to say?
I don't know. Something. I was just thinking about...
I'm good at making sure, like, the pets... No.
It doesn't matter. Where I was headed with that is... I wanted to just do a gratitude thing. Well, fuck. I'm not ready.
What are you, Oprah?
I am Oprah. I had a bunch of things I was going to discuss about, but I got so scrambled with other stuff I'm trying to handle that I'm kind of all over the place.
I was going to say that today sucked.
It did suck. My fucking printer went out. I've been very annoyed in here.
It's been the same on the other side of the studio.
I know. I heard you say that this is the worst fucking day.
It's not anything bad.
Respectively.
It's just I had a lot of things that I was trying to get done, and I just needed to go for a run to just let it all out, and I just couldn't. It was just one of those days where, like, you can feel that building of energy, and you can't release it because there's just too much other crap you got to do.
Yeah.
It was one of those days.
Yep, it really was. It's not, yeah, people have worse days. There's definitely...
Hey, did you hear the new sport for the Olympics? What's coming to the summer? I think it's the Summer Olympics.
Skateboarding.
Breakdancing.
Oh, yeah, that was a thing on the... Yeah, they were wanting to do that for a little while. I did know that.
Isn't that cool?
Yeah, it's flipping awesome.
And then I saw that Spotify is laying off 6% of its workforce.
Why? They make too much money?
Oh, that's what I was thinking. Like, why? And they're not paying any, not really paying any of the artists. A couple pennies to the gazillions of listens. So that's interesting. And then Google is also laying off employees. And they're going to be announcing some new AI this summer. And so the techies are losing their jobs to AI.
What is going on?
I'm bringing this up for a reason because... There is a few new lawsuits about the art generating AI. Oh. Artists are having a class action.
Yeah.
So what's happening is the AI is just kind of training right now, so it's scrubbing the internet. It's using all the different artists' renditions of things.
Yeah.
And it's kind of, I don't know, it's a slippery slope. I think that if I were you, I would put like one of those I am not a robot checkbox things on your website before you enter. I mean, I don't know how else you do it. You hide it behind a paywall, but no one's going to pay to get on your website. I don't know that anyone would click I am not a robot to get on your website.
What does it matter?
Well, because if someone put in like, so you know how you go to...
Can I interrupt you real quick?
That person's not going to buy it anyway.
If someone's buying AI artwork, fuck them.
Well, you know, you go to the gallery or somewhere, you know the people, you go to the gallery or something and they say, I could do that.
Yeah.
And then they take a picture of it, intend to make something like it, never do. Well, they take a picture at this time, they feed it those words, whatever it is, describe it into the AI.
Yeah.
And then it says like, oh, make a George Washington crossing the Delaware in the style of ArtByTai or Tai Tai Wali'i.
It still doesn't bug me.
And then they can send it to Walmart to get a canvas print of it like later that day.
Sure. But an AI generated it. It didn't come from me, so.
But they're using your work to create it.
Yeah, I get it. I understand. But I don't, people buy my artwork. I can only speak for myself, but they buy my artwork because they get a sense of who I am through the artwork, and there's a connection between me and them.
But this is like what Hobby Lobby does on a significantly larger scale.
Sure. But what am I going to do? I don't care. I really don't. Surprisingly, I don't.
You might want to care.
Why? What am I going to care
about
it?
Because government is too slow. Like if your rights as an artist and a creative human being gets overrun by a computer system.
Oh, I don't care.
Well, then you're out of a job later.
I mean, it happens. But what am I going to do?
The class action lawsuit, I think, is good just not because... Not like you're trying to get money or anything, but that is quicker than the government and policies.
Yeah, I'm just saying.
Because they're doing it with lyrics too. Did you see that Nick Cave? You know Nick Cave, that Australian artist.
I know.
Singer.
Yeah.
And they did his lyrics like Nick Cave's and auto generated.
They did it with music. It happened with music.
They auto generate.
Sure.
Lyrics.
But I still only want music from the artist to make, it falls on the people who listen to music and who enjoy artwork. And if people no longer want to buy artwork from an artist, then that's on them, not on me. And then my career as an artist goes away, that's fine.
You would be lost.
I'll be fucking pissed and shit, whatever, but I'm not gonna there's way too many battles to fight in this life, and I'm not gonna fight that battle. I would rather put my energy into reminding people why they buy my artwork than fighting some other computer generated
you don't have
bullshit.
To, like
that,
fight and
yeah, no,
you just
but I
add
mean,
your name with all
sure,
the other
if
artists.
They want, okay, let me rephrase. If they want me to sign a petition, I'll sign a petition. But I think it still falls on people. If you want artwork from artists, then fucking buy their artwork.
But there are people who don't, who have never like, has never been part of their.
Well, what am I
art culture.
Yeah, then
I'm
that's
saying.
Oh, yeah. Then that's on them, though. I mean,
well, I know, but then there's no opportunity to learn that. Like, some people of this new generation may never know that, like, you once bought music.
Yeah, they won't. But the world is changing.
So that might fall into that same category.
It might, and that would suck.
You don't buy art. You just...
But I just keep selling to the people who are in my age, and those people. I'm going to die. Or I'm going to age with the same people who buy my work. We're going to all get older together. They'll keep buying my artwork, and maybe we'll pick up some young ones where they're like, oh, it's hip to buy artwork. You know, like that whole thing. That's why vinyl's making a comeback.
I kind of figured you wouldn't give a shit, but...
I know. Well, let me just say this real quick before we go to break and come on with the guys from Sk8 Liborius Church. I'm not new to collecting music. I've been collecting music my whole life. But I'm new to collecting vinyl. And since we have a lot of discussions with musicians on the show, I just wanted to, when I get the chance on every episode, any new vinyl that comes in that I've been collecting for the week, I just wanted to share it. So I figured I'd do that real quick. Real fast. Or do you think that's dumb? Isn't that boring?
I don't know. It seems braggy.
Oh, does it?
I don't know.
It's not. It's actually, I want to celebrate. Yeah, okay.
No, I don't know if it is or not. Ooh,
It's fine. Because I was going to say, I don't. I'm all over the place. Close family and oh boy, I'm like, let's just get right into the episode. There's nothing on you. I was on my run today. I saw a goose head from neck up, cut off.
Someone cut off a goose
head? I don't know. It was just laying on the cement.
Oh God,
on the sidewalk.
Got a serial killer nearby.
I was thinking, where does that come from? What is that?
They don't just get their necks chopped off.
Right, but did a dog catch it or something?
Was it a quick, like a nice slicely severed?
There was a bone. Well, I'm showing the picture right now as we're talking because I took a picture of it on my run this morning. I guess my question was, is that a sign?
No, it's not a sign.
Well, you know how people like to do. Can I just ask the audience if you think, if that's a sign, what do you suppose the sign is? We don't necessarily believe in signs, do we?
I don't know.
Well, I have a trillion things.
I know what a stop... I believe in stop signs.
I have a trillion things that I wanted to talk about, but we're going to get through that on another episode. The other day, I was struggling to say... I was saying it's a hypothetical question.
Mm-hmm.
The word just came to me 2 days ago, or a day ago. On the last episode, I was like, hypothetical... Rhetorical... That's a question you're not expecting an answer. I had that in my notes because it was driving me bonkers. All right, you know what? Let's take a quick break. I agree with you about the braggy thing. I was mostly just wanting to show, to share the music. But yeah, you might be right. So, okay. I am all over the place.
I don't know.
I apologize.
I know you buy a lot of stuff, so.
Yeah, it wasn't that. It was mostly like, I just want to share these albums because... One of them is this album. See, I want to market that. Not market, but I want to share that with people. This is a great
album. Well, that one makes
album.
Sense to share because you did the cover.
Because I did the album cover for. Yeah, I don't know. All right. Well, forget everything I said. Blank your minds and take... Here's how we clear your head. Like in Men in Black with these ads, and we'll be right back with the boys from Sk8 Liborius. We'll be right back.
DOD45.
Hob sauce.
We're real thrilled to have partnered with Hob sauce for three simple reasons. Their hot sauce is delicious, the owner and creator David is a solid dude, and they collaborate with dope artists for their labels, including myself. Boom. Amplify your favorite foods with their award-winning flavors. Head over to HobSauces.com to get yourself some absolutely delicious artisan hot sauce. Hit it, Bobby.
Hab sauce. What you gonna do? What you gonna do? Put it on your food.
Hob sauce.
Charge. Hey, what's up? This is A Wall One, and I'm back to tell you another little super secret. have a new album coming out. It's called Scribble Face. And Scribble Face is dropping on January 26th. It'll be streaming everywhere. It'll be on vinyl, brought to you by Audio Recon. And it'll be distributed to the world by my friends at Alpha Pup. This really, 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 really tasty record was mastered by my friend Daddy Kev. And we recorded some of it with my other friend DJ Hoppa. It has an all-star posse cut and very, very, very juicy lyrics for you. A Wall 1 Scribble Face, January 26th, if you can eat it.
Check out our new partners, Brim of the World, aka Sea Conquer and Destroy, aka Aliens Built Earth. I'm always wearing their gear, especially the hats, and in almost every episode of the DOD45, you'll see me rocking something from these cats, because I'm a fan. Show them some love and treat yourself right to a new wardrobe or some new headgear, and I'm not talking about braces headgear, I'm talking about hats. Check out all their gear and links at brimoftheworld.com.
This is flyover country. No one's expecting much from us. In fact, no one's expecting anything at all. The coast probably think we're at Walmart right now.
Great deal on fire, by the way.
Instead, here we are making plans. Big plans. Because in a city where people do so much with so little, what could happen if we gave them more? More beauty, connections, perspectives.
This is your chance to be a part of something bigger than yourself.
Something that's made of brick, concrete, and steel. But also for blood, sweat, and soul. Something that could only be possible in St. Louis. Because when no one's expecting much from you, you can do anything. Our city deserves something epic. Long live Laborious.
Hey, real quick, my friends. My art is available for purchase at ArtByTai.com. So if you like what you're seeing or you want to support the DOD45 show, the best way for you to do that is to pick up a print or an original at my website. If you're not quite ready to buy but you still want to help out, leave us a review on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever else you stream from. And make sure you subscribe to my YouTube channel at ArtByTai and engage in the comments. That goes a long way. All right, enough already. Let's get back to the show. We're back. And just as we're back, we're checking in with these. Check out these hoodlums.
What's up? What's going on,
Tash? That building.
Yeah, you guys. It's like you guys. It's like that behind you. It's almost like it's a
Catholic cathedral or something.
Yeah, like a neo Gothic cathedral.
Yeah, it's all, but it's not real. It's like you guys aren't really there. That's just your background.
Okay, real quick, we should probably explain a little bit of going on here. No.
Well, we'll get to that.
Okay.
Yeah, I got things lined up. Well, guys, I'm happy to have you. I'm happy that you guys are on the show. I don't even know how I came across it. So we have a place in Hannibal, Missouri. So, we found out. Yeah, I think I was watching some old skate videos and like on YouTube it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how I found out. It's just awesome now that I do know because
thanks,
you're only 100 miles from us. So
yeah, come down, check it out sometime.
Mm-hmm. We're going to for sure.
Okay, who's who?
I'm Dave.
Dave.
I'm Bryan.
Bryan.
They call me Bedwell too.
It's been like a hell of a scrambling kind of day today. So I like just barely figured out what I was going to draw for you guys. But really the whole point of having you guys on is, I love skateboarding. I love skateboarding culture and I love old cathedrals and,
we got all those.
Yeah. Yeah. You're in the right place, my friend.
I want to support the church. Is it Liborius or Liborius or
it's Liborius. So, he was like, St. Liborius was like the patron saint of like gallstones. Yeah. It was just kind of funny in Paderborn, Germany. So like when you see statues of him, he's always like holding a little rock in his hand.
Because
back in the day, the river in Paderborn had lots of calcium in it. And so he would like use the Holy Ghost to cure it. Now we know that like, do you just pass those things eventually because we have science now. But back then they were like, oh, he cured us of the gallstones. But you just sort of pass them.
So this was the cathedral. Was it a cathedral?
So it's a church, technically. Cathedral is like the seat of a bishop, as we've been corrected by many know-it-alls online over and over again.
Sure, they do that.
Yeah, they sure do. It's the oldest neo-Gothic church west of the Mississippi River.
Oh, okay.
Oh, it's so great.
If you're not Catholic, you'd think it's a cathedral.
It's appropriate size of a cathedral. Cathedrals are usually bigger, so it's a cathedral size building, but it's technically a church.
Wow. The columns go right through the decks on the half pipe. I fucking love that.
it's already got the smallest flat bottom of like most rear engine size anyway from around because of the reason why I just squish it in there.
Yeah, it's awesome. Okay, I'm gonna start the timer to start getting the drawing going, and I got some specific questions so we can, like I said, I want people to know about Sk8 Liborius.
Laborious.
So I want to share with people because you guys take like donations and stuff to help the project, right?
Yeah, we're in the middle of a big fundraiser right now. So we have to get this, but we've been running this underground for like 10, 11 years now. Like I got this building for free years ago and Holiday homies put a skate park in it. But originally we funded the entire thing by just like, we turned the basement is the same square footage as up here. Big so park. We just do giant like raves and punk shows to like buy materials to fix the building up because it was like almost too far gone.
We just hired off-duty cops for security guards so that way we don't get in trouble. And we were good.
Yeah, we just do ragers, and like that's how we bought all the materials to make the building up.
Awesome.
And so, but in 2016 we started a nonprofit called the Lewis and Laborious Urban Art Studios that's actually going to like facilitate all the like youth outreach and stuff that we're doing here and all the art and everything. And so we have to do a fundraising campaign right now. We need to raise around $1 million to get the building up to occupancy code, and also just to be able to run organizations. Because
all that stuff, you know, it's a lot. It's like it seems like a lot of money, but if you think about it, we have to do like all new electric. There's a huge like rear egress that we have to build because the back stairs are too small. We're going to be able to have 300 or 400 people in here for the occupancy. So that's like bigger than it has been in the more recent past. It was basically just like a homeless shelter, like a food pantry in the basement for a long time before we moved in. So they need a big occupancy for that. So because of that reason, a lot of things are in disrepair and there's just a lot of things. The electric alone is like $600,000.
Yeah. And we're lucky. We've all just been, me and Bedwell and a lot of the other folks that we work on our, you know, we've all been contractors our whole life. Like Bedwell owns a concrete company, I own a metal fabrication company, but just adaptive reusing these buildings is like really challenging. Like for example, like above us, there's these holes like in the ceiling and like that's where the chandeliers used to hang. You could walk up in the attic and there's these cranks and the priest would crank them down to the ground so they could light all the candles and then crank them back up again. And like, so like just the line loss, the voltage drop from running electric in a room this big and like, it's just like, for like Edison invented a light bulb in 1879. They started building this church in 1850. Like,
yeah, you know, like so electricity. Abraham Lincoln or whatever, they started building this place.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Just the roof alone. If you had any, just the roof, that's a fortune.
Well, luckily it's a slate roof, so that made it last a lot longer than a lot of things. But it was really close to being done when we got a hold of it done. There was a lot of bad leaks in the gutter zones that were just pouring into the building.
Yeah, it's like waterfalls in here every time it rained. I think if we'd have got it 5 years later than we got it, it'd have been like past kind of, you know, eventually you don't do repair anymore. You just have to tear out huge shit and replace it, which is like tax at zero on the cost of doing anything. And so, I mean, it was pretty fucked when we got it. It was pretty fucked.
Yeah. Well, I think it's awesome that you guys are bringing it back to life.
Thanks, man.
All right, let me ask you this. Here's a question. This one's going to be for David. Say they made a movie about Sk8 Liborius and about the process of redoing this place. Who would you want to play you, David Duchovny or David Arquette?
Oh, shit, David Arquette.
Oh, that was too easy.
David Arquette, yeah. No, I'm not knocking David Duchovny. I mean, he's Mulder, bro. He is Mulder. I don't know, maybe David Duchovny. I mean, he just got this like low monotone sort of delivery. Like,
he seems like a more of a quiet guy.
Yeah,
you're not a quiet guy. I'm not a quiet guy.
Yeah, David Arquette would have a little more fun with it, right? Do you have a personality that's more like a David Arquette kind of personality?
I'm probably more than David Duchovny. If I had to.
Would you rather spend an evening with Joss Stone or Sharon Stone?
Sharon Stone. I'm 42 though, so you know.
Yeah, no, I think
she's got to be like 60.
She is, and I bet Joss Stone is probably about 39 or something.
Joss Stone's a singer.
I don't really even know who that is.
She's a singer. She did that Red Stripes cover that got ruined. It was pretty good.
Yeah, she came on the scene pretty strong, and then like I have no idea what she's up to now.
She came out like around like Macy Gray, and there was like that neo soul revival thing in like the early 2000s. She was part of all that.
Yeah. Well, all right. So then here's one for you, Brian.
I'm just saying, face against it. Come on.
Yeah, I know. But you think that Sharon Stone is gonna be like that when you spend the night with? And I just mean like hang out, spend the night. I'm.
Well, I mean, I've been trying to hang out with women more close to my own age anyway, so that might be good.
If you could only sleep in one for the rest of your life, which would you prefer, a bunk bed or a hide a bed?
Bunk bed.
Oh.
Really? Because you have to climb down that. If you're on the top bunk, you have to climb down every night.
I think
that's
just going
to
keep me limber, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. Just keep moving, you know. Top you never bunk. Slow down, you never grow old. We climb it up and down every day. It's like top bunk.
Brian, who would write a better song for Sk8 Liborius, Bryan Adams or Bryan Johnson?
I'd say Bryan Johnson.
Yeah. Adrian, let's ask Adrian. Adrian, do you know who Bryan Johnson is?
I love him.
He's from ACDC.
Oh. I mean, don't get me wrong. You know, that Bryan Adams, when they did that, what was it, Robin Hood movie? He was hot. Don't get me wrong.
It's the banger. It's the Bryan.
Think about guys in tights dancing around.
All right. Well, so enough of the stupid fucking questions. David, you worked on the City Museum, right?
Yeah.
Is there any place like the City Museum anywhere in the world?
Not really. There's other places that are like kind of attraction exhibits now, but City Museum's the first. We just had 25 year anniversary, and a lot of those other types of attraction spots like Factory Obscura, Now Wolf, and stuff like that. A lot of those guys, when they were starting those places, they were fans of the museum, and they came and kind of talked to us about.
Well, most of their stuff's like installation artwork type stuff.
Right. Like the difference, I think, is that a lot of other, and this is not to knock those places. Yeah, it's just different. It's that like those places kind of like look real but are fake,
right.
And the museum like looks fake but it's real, like you know, like when you go
it's
to
really
like
an airplane float in the air, you fly.
Right.
Yeah, like when you go to Disney, if you go to the big hotels, they look like they have these giant like timber beams, but if you knock on them, they're all fiberglass.
Yeah.
You know, it looks real fake. Where the museum, like that's a real fucking castle. Like, we built that shit. We cut stone, stacked them, carved them. We like pick shit up with cranes and weld it all in. Like it looks like it's not real, but it is real. Like,
it is very real.
Yeah. That's great that you say that, because that's kind of how we explain it when we have people come in town. We're like, you have to go to the City Museum. It's not like you're going to the faux Disney World. It's like a real.
Yeah, it's gritty, its own thing.
It's a gritty adult playground. It's fucking awesome.
Adult and kid.
Yeah, it's
the kids love it too.
I can tell you crazy City Museum stories for 10 podcasts. It was a while. It was definitely the most like formative thing that job I've ever had.
Did you see? Well, we just saw that there's a loft for sale in there for $450,000.
Bob's loft. Yeah.
Oh,
Bob's
loft. That was. Oh, okay.
Is Bob? Who's Bob?
Bob Cassidy was like my boss. He was the creator of the City Museum. We did a quote of his up on the wall about one can ascertain the success of a project based upon the resistance of its bureaucracy. That like if you're doing shit that's pissing people off, it's probably an indication you're doing something good.
Yeah, right.
So yeah, Bob was like a 4-year-old with a checkbook, and he just like built, you know.
He was a great guy. I got to be very lucky because I was friends with Dave during that time when he was alive. We got to meet him and stuff, and he's just like a really weird guy to talk to, but amazing. Like you just see like his brain working all the time. It's crazy.
How old was he when he died?
I was in his early 60s and stuff. Yeah, but he was just a wild Willy Wonka artist guy, like crazy sculptor. Oh, after he died, all people come to us on the crew. They'd be like, you guys are going to finish everything. You know what Bob was doing. I was like, I don't know that Bob knew what Bob was doing. Bob just did shit. He just fucking did it. And like, you know, and it was all real, like, stream of consciousness for him. I mean, he was just a wild dude. And it always was. Like, a bunch of the guys in the crew were like, we'd all been together for years and years and years. And a lot of guys knew Bob growing, like, when he was young growing up. And he was just always just kind of done it his way. The wild guy.
Are there like ever additions to that? Like, is it an unfinished project or is it?
Nothing's ever finished. Right. I mean, like, no, Bob would just come to us, like, you know, he would tear stuff out and we'd redo it. He'd just show up every morning and be like, okay, so here's what we're gonna do today. We're gonna get the big tube and then we'll make a slide and it goes down, it looks like a dragon, and then it goes in the pool. Okay, and then he'd walk away and we're just like, what fucking tubes? You know, I'll get the torches. You know what Kurt, you know what the dragon is? And like, and then sometimes he'd come back, he'd be like, this is great, and then he's, this is fucking terrible, tear it all out, what the fuck are you doing? Yeah, it's just news is like that. It is awesome.
Well, So one of the things that I always wonder when I'm in there, because we go quite, I mean, we try to go often. I fucking love the place. I also love that there's a bar in there.
The cabin in. Yeah. The cabin in.
Yeah, yes. It's awesome that you can go to a space like that where, and the reason I say nothing like that would ever exist anywhere, which is also similar to what you guys have there. Maybe Missouri has different laws, but like.
St. Louis, man. There's a lot of people get murdered around here. So don't you worry about it.
I think three of the five murder top murder places are all in Missouri.
Missouri, yeah.
I think it's all the three big cities.
I think maybe you get away with it in like Detroit or Gary, Indiana, or like, you know, it's like you have a lot of these towns, kind of the Rust Belt towns.
Anything is better than what's there right now. So if somebody wants to throw some money at or do something, it's like, okay, that's okay. Yeah.
You would never get away with a city museum in like downtown Los Angeles.
Well, we built on like DIY skate park, but on a concrete over like 6-year period of time underneath this bridge in the city of St. Louis here, and nobody even like said shit to us at first.
Jinx Highway, rest in peace.
Full on like legit thing.
I wonder, maybe lawsuit laws are a little bit different that in St. Louis? No,
I mean people can sue anybody for anything.
I think it's more true. Policing, you know. Right. Just say they've got time. They ain't got no money downtown to be paying people to come look around for that kind of shit or whatever.
Yeah, and just like, you know, they have a lot of
city.
I think also with us in particular, and also with the city museum, like, you know, it's just abandoned buildings. There's nothing going on. Mm-hmm. And like something's better than nothing. I mean, the city museum now sees like 850,000 visitors a year. And I mean, we have people come, we're not even open yet. We have people from all over the world that come here that like make a point to come to St. Louis just to skate the church. And it's like, was very recently just like a rundown abandoned building. We're just building crap and throwing parties in. And you know, and I think that it's kind of like when a door closes, a window opens type of situation, that you have a lot of underserved areas and kind of urban blight, but in that there's a lot of opportunities to do cool shit that you can't get away with in a lot of other cities because they'll just regulate, red tape you out of existence.
That's what regulations are always destroy fun things. But that being said, what is the, is there a, I always wonder when I'm at the city museum, what's the fire escape plan?
There's fire escapes. We actually just put two in. Like me and so during the pandemic, Premier Parks owns it now. It's a big theme park company. They bought it off Bob's partner, Dave. They laid off a bunch of Bob's crew. And so we snatched all our guys up and we started another company. Now we call BLA Studios, like blah, like BLA. And we build weird city museum shit all over the place. And we just built two fire escapes for the city museum. We cut huge holes in the roof and built two steel fire escapes that connected into the concrete fire escapes that went down there. And so like, it's safe there. It's just like kind of this illusion of danger. Yeah. And like, I mean, you know, and some of it is not that much, a very thin veneer of illusion.
It's kind of dangerous.
Like, yeah, I mean, it can be kind of, but like, you know, that's good. Like, it's good for kids to like, you should skin your knee, like fall down and break your arm and like do something scary and cry and get through it. Like, that's important to do that shit.
And a lot of things, especially here in America, or at least I feel, everything has a guardrail or a safety precaution everywhere you go.
It's
like
kind
we
of
went to a long time ago. We went to a bunch of castles when our kids were little up over in Europe, and we were just like, "Wow, the kids could just fall right off of it." We just we didn't realize how many safety barriers we had here on everything until we went over there and saw how few they had.
I think that a lot of that is the fear of being sued, though. You know.
Yeah, that's what it is. All money. You know, I'm at this point, it's all money. Everybody just wants to get some money somehow, so it's like you can't do anything.
Exactly. Yeah, no, you said it right there, man. Like, and so like that leads to like Bob found funny solutions for that shit. Like, I remember one day he had me, I think it was me and Daniel. He was like, "You guys are going to go up and weld." He's like, "Somebody got stuck." I'm like, "What do you mean somebody got stuck?" He's like, "Yeah, over the weekend, someone got stuck. So we got to weld fatty bars in." I'm like, "What do you mean fatty?" So all the a bunch of the tunnels, he had us weld a bar in the middle of them. And when all of them, Sam, Bob called them fatty because, like, well, fat kids are getting stuck in them and you don't want to get sued. So he just had us weld bars so fat kids can fit them anymore. If you can squeeze into the tunnel, then you're good to go. And, yeah. Like, you know, like that's not really a good solution.
No, yeah.
I know. I've been into some of those. I've been into some of those tunnels and went, like, I'm not fitting. But you're just like a cat. You just get out of there.
With the people we have taken there, some of the we have some friends that are like super cautious about everything, and guess who was the only person that gets hurt? All the people we've taken, the most cautious person is the one that got hurt.
She put her hands up.
She was going down the slide. I said, "What?" Every time we would do the slide, I'm like, "Don't reach up. The sign says, don't try to grab anything." And she tried to reach up and grab and her ring got caught. But it doesn't matter. It's not like she died or anything. It was no big deal. It was just funny that she was
I feel like getting lined.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's different. It's much different now that it's
lawyers out front.
Yeah, it's owned by like now the Premier Parks owns it. I mean, I didn't work for Premier Parks. I was not at the museum long before they took over. But you know, when Bob had it, it was a mania, you know.
When did they buy that out?
It's been a couple years now.
Okay, because we haven't been since the pandemic.
Yeah,
so
since their first part.
It'll be interesting to go back.
So Bryan, I saw that you had posted some a whole bunch of bowls or something that you were working on. Some concrete bowls or something. Is that a new skate park going in somewhere?
I do a bunch of. That's what I do for a living. I own a concrete skate park building company. We travel around the United States. Skateboard parks everywhere. So
yeah,
right now we're working on one in Phoenix. My guys are down there working hard. It's always hard in concrete. Shut up.
So you're doing that in Phoenix right now, you said?
Yeah, that's where my kids out in Phoenix right now. We're doing another one right out outside of Phoenix right after that.
You're all over the place, though.
Yeah, this year we're gonna be in New York a couple times. We're gonna be in Illinois a couple times.
So. That's awesome.
So yeah, we just did a bunch of skate parks with reservations recently.
Oh cool.
Oh fuck yeah.
In Arizona.
Are the skate parks usually like privately funded, or are they like government funded skate parks?
Government funded mostly. Oh, they're awesome. The parks department from the city or whatever. Like the one from Phoenix right now is like right in the middle of their like midtown area, which is like severely underserved with skate parks anyway. Like there's a lot of skate parks outside of Phoenix, like in the surrounding areas, the counties. But there isn't really any in the inner city, so this would be the first one there. So it's pretty cool.
That's fucking awesome.
I feel like need it more anyway, you know. The
for sure.
More lower income people, skateboarding is good for that. You know,
yeah, so. Rich white kids got enough skate parks in their cities, right?
Right.
I always say that I spent most of my life on my skateboard, but then my wife reminds me that I'm old and that I actually have now been alive.
You spent most of your youth on a skateboard.
Most of my youth on a skateboard, I guess. So, hey, who's been the most famous skater to skate the ramps over there at Liborius?
Little Wayne came through once.
Yeah, right.
Not the most famous person.
I mean, Christian Asoy.
We just saw him.
Darren Everett. Ton of people. We had the one time it was like they did like a some kind of punk rock paintbrushes art show. Through doing that, there's a bunch more guys in, and then I mean, we get a pretty good flow of people coming through just randomly. It'd be somebody that
the whole Volcom team came through a while ago.
Yeah, we had some commerce dudes too.
Man, that's awesome. When they do that, do you like rent the space out, or is it like?
Sometimes Commerce actually came in and they gave us some money. They did like a little private contest through Zoomies here.
Yeah. They built some ramps.
And they paid a couple guys to come out for ramp construction to build
they paid us too, I think.
Yeah, to build some new ramps for our street course. And then they gave us money that we built more stuff out with the same time. So it's pretty cool.
We've done a Red Bull Cornerstone event.
Like 3 years in a row we did that.
Yeah.
Is that, so, I saw that. I watched some of the footage from the Red Bull contest. Are they going to, will you continue doing like some Red Bull?
Yeah, they're working on a different contest though now. They're getting away from the Cornerstone, I guess, whatever franchise, whatever the hell they want to call it. They're like, they're doing something different now, basically. Sure. But they're talking about it happening soon. By the end of this year, they're talking about doing so.
Because they do a bunch of contests and they have different stops at different skate parks. And so, like, we were a stop on the Cornerstone one, and I'm sure we'll be a stop on whatever the Cornerstone replacement one is.
Right.
So Eric over at Red Bull is an awesome dude.
I'm trying to figure out if you could tell me in the amount of truckloads, maybe, how much pigeon shit came out of that the upstairs.
Like two dump trucks.
Well, it was like 7 tons almost. We dumped it all out the window and then it turned into a giant pile out there. And then we went, got a skid steer, picked it up with that, and loaded it into a dumpster that like blew the bottom of the dumpster out. And the dude like tried to lift it up, like the whole front of his truck was lifted up in the air. And he's like this like independent contractor guy. He was freaking out. We're like, just go. And he finally pulled it up on there.
Fucking bury the needle. Get it, man.
Yeah, it ended up being like $1,200 or something to dump it, even on top of what we already paid him.
Well, first we just shoved it out of the tower. Like the tower was full. Like all the stairs were like ramps. They'd be completely filled in with pigeon shit.
Wow. But are you
insulation.
Are you exaggerating the 7 tons? Or, I mean, was it?
That's legit. It was a pot. Like if you figured the entire tower full of stairs, all those stairs and landings with like a foot thick pigeon shit, we just started at the top and like shoveled it down like where the bell used to hang, and the pile that was at the bottom of the bell was like I don't know, probably 4 feet above my head. And it was all
Well, then from there we just hit a bucket brigade out the window, and then on top of that, I mean, don't get me wrong, it was probably like wet too, so it wasn't just like a full 7 tons of pigeon shit, but it was
That's a shitload of weight that's just like sitting up there.
It actually sort of worked like a sponge because the tower at the time didn't really have any windows, so water would pour in.
Yeah,
and so, like, it kind of like the pile of pigeon shit, like, soaked up the rainwater and let it evaporate slowly.
Like you said earlier, it was like insulated the floor from rotting out.
Yeah.
It didn't smell good.
No.
Nature doing its thing.
That's right.
What are the volunteer days? Do you guys still do those?
Yeah, we actually got some coming up this weekend. Yeah, we're trying to get back into this year doing it at least once a month where we have volunteer. You know, it turns into kind of like a little skate session, hang out. Also, you know, sometimes we got a lot to do, sometimes we got as much to do, but let's be open all day, get some spots, get some free beers or something going for the guys.
And so just people will come and provide what they can do, help out.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of it's just like picking up stuff, moving it, sweeping it, you know, whatever, stuff like that, maintenance type stuff. We'll usually have like a one or two big projects. Like this week, we're going to just be moving a whole bunch of shit. There's one area that we're trying to open up to be able to use for like a merchandise area because we're starting to get more t-shirts and stuff made. So we're just, you know, just be moving a lot of stuff around, carrying stuff down to the basement, carrying stuff around the building.
Is there an age requirement? Like you have to be
No, I mean, anybody come through. We try to
kind of like an open house day too. You know what I mean? People can just kind of come through.
A lot of people want to check the place out and stuff. And we try to coordinate like larger construction with those days if we can. But a lot of times that stuff like concrete pours where we get a man lift to work on the roof of the gutters. Yeah. It's more like skilled work. We all do that type of work. We have a bunch of homies that also are in construction and trades. And so sometimes we'll try to like coordinate our volunteer day because it's nice to have like ground guys hand me that bucket. While we're working on stuff, you know, but
we definitely try to make it like on the big volunteer days where there's a lot of stuff that anybody can do, because you know how it is. I mean, if you're gonna take your time to come somewhere to help out or whatever, then you show up and they're like, oh, we ain't got nothing for you to do, that's kind of a bummer. Try to think where there's at least like a couple different skill levels of tasks to be, you know,
we ain't got no shortage of shit to do.
I've been doing volunteer stuff with the skating community here in St. Louis for a long time. That's one of the things we always just try to stick by it, like, you know, make sure there's something for everybody to do. So that way when they show up, they feel included, you know?
Yeah.
Anybody carry a bucket?
You can take the time out of your day to do something, you want to do it, right?
Right.
Plus it makes them feel like if people get involved in it, they like when you, it makes you feel like, oh yeah, I accomplished something. I'm part of this whole project. It makes them.
Yeah. Sense of ownership.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That's a big part.
Are you guys going to continue to do shows?
Yeah, that was one of my questions.
Yeah, we want to. I mean, it bums us out that we can't do it anymore. We just, you know, now that we kept it
in
the future for sure. Like once we get our occupancy permit back up and we get everything, we get all of it set, we'll get right back to doing events. I mean, the shows are sort of a means to an end, you know, like, unfortunately, you know, like
funding, we're taking a lot of risk on.
Funding everything by throwing giant illegal parties is not a sustainable long-term business model.
Right.
So, like,
no, but like when the building is done, when it's funded, and then you could have all age shows or.
Oh, for sure.
Oh, yeah. We just needed money. We needed materials. Yeah. You know, we had to fix the building. And so we did whatever we could do. Like, and that was a quick way to make money quick because we need bricks and concrete and roofing tiles and anything that we needed because the building, every time it rains, it gets a little bit worse, a little bit worse.
We fixed all the gutters. We've done tons of stuff already. Tunnel electricity already. You know,
I think we described it as stabilized. The building is stabilized.
So the water's not pouring in. And then the spots we had issues with the plumbing is fixed. You know, we have some newer electricity. You go into the building. We've done a lot. We actually had a really good push this past summer because we got a hold of this big man lift and got a lot of our roof. There was a lot of flashing. It was
shout out to Jesse at University Roofing.
University Roof. He hooked it up. He came out and you know, our roof's a super old slate roof, and they're like, you know, they're meant to last like 200 years. So that's one good thing we have going for us. But
we're at 160.
Yeah, more like at 160. So yeah, there's like a bunch of flashing and stuff that was all messed up. So, and there's still a couple spots we're gonna get back to, but she's pretty well shored up at this point. So it's good.
Are a lot of the materials do companies donate materials?
They have for sure, but I mean, for the most part,
not that much. A lot of times we got homies that like, you know, do like tuck pointing, so it was a real good deal, you know, so you still pay them a little bit, but you get a little bit knocked off.
Yeah. And like we've had stuff donated to us before, but I mean, for the most part,
City Museum used to do all kinds of stuff.
Yeah. City Museum gave us like 10 pallets of glass block. We got, Rick over at the museum and Leaf hooked it up. And then, but I mean, for the most part, we just buy it. Like, we just throw big ragers and take the money and go to Home Depot.
And we're tax exempt because we have our nonprofit status, so we got like a number over there, so you at least don't have to pay taxes on it.
Right. Yeah, without having to call it a church.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So yeah, I guess.
I'm sure you could be a church.
Probably could.
What would be the like, say there was just no amount of, or you know, no worry about whatever it costed, if you had got all the funding to make it all right, what would be the ideal, you know, if you were to talk to if you got a genie and said like, we want all this done, and this is what we want this whole place to be for.
So, like, what do you think? Talking about, like, final product when we're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
I think some of us have different ideas.
Yeah, we do.
I'd definitely like to express mine.
Yeah. You do yours first, then I'll do mine. We'll go back and forth.
Well, mine is we would have the skate park obviously open. We've talked about doing an upper level, like, floating area. We have, like, a pump track that kind of goes around the ceiling with,
I'm all for that.
Like, a observation area by the front, big windows and stuff that kind of looks down over everything.
Over the skate park, so you can watch the kids skate.
Like a pump track and maybe just like a walking track around it, you know, that's like floating. Like, it seems like YMCA is above like the
connect the decks of a bunch of the world
or whatever, you know, something like that. And then also have like a full-on like gym in the basement with like, you know, bathrooms and locker rooms and stuff like that, so that this place becomes like a full-on training facility. And then with the building next door and the extra spaces that we have it to be like Airbnb / like a place for somebody with training for like the Olympics or something can come here and stay, and they can have a place to skate. They can stay right here in the building. They can have a gym that they can work out in, you know. And then on top of that, the other parts of the basement would be like a big learning facility that would have like a wood shop, welding area, a big classroom, and then a big event space down there.
I was probably going to say the concrete skate park.
Yeah, well, I want the concrete skate park in the basement, but everybody's pushing back on that.
I was just saying, I'm not against it. I'm just saying, you can always pour a concrete skate park. You just can't unpour a concrete skate park.
Yeah, you can. I do it all the time.
Yeah, not as easily.
You don't want to put the concrete skateboard out or skate park outside.
Is there a yard space at all? Is there like acreage space?
The neighbors actually want us to build a little ramp for them this coming summer.
I'm all for that in the courtyard.
In the garden. I've been thinking about it. I got some ideas of how we can put the ramp that goes in between the garden and our zone.
So that's,
don't you guys have a community garden there too or something?
Right, that's next door. That's New Roots. So that's
New Roots, they're amazing over there.
Yeah, that's
Antoine's the man.
Yeah, Antoine rules, man. So that's sort of how I wound up getting this building, is that like I run a farm with my wife down south of here called Such and
Dutch farm. We do like permaculture and custom farming and farm dinners and work with chefs and raise goats and pigs and chickens and ducks and shoot guns and ride four wheelers and blow shit up. And so at the time, I didn't really know anything about farming. And so I just showed up at that urban farm because I drove by it before. And there was a guy working there. And I was like, maybe we can work together on farming. And he was like, yeah, sure. But like, do you know anything about working on old buildings? And I was like, well, yeah, I work at the city museum. I know a lot about that. And he was like, nobody wants to help me climb up in the tower, shovel all that fucking pigeon shit out. And I was like, that's cool, bro. Like, let's go get those shovels. We'll go on up there. And so we, through that farm, though, I mean, that's kind of what led to us getting this, wow, this building, you know, is that then we kind of found out the status of the building and what was going on with it and wound up getting it.
Oh, that's so great. Or is all the glass like original glass, or was a lot of that had to be replaced? The windows. Oh, I
so,
see.
It was all Emil Fry Glass Company made all the glass, and like kind of back in the 1900s, it was really like them and Tiffany's that.
It's worth like thousands of dollars. It's all gone.
Most of it was stolen before we got here. All the Munich pictorial stained glass, it has images of Christ and shit like that. Mm-hmm. That stuff's like $300 a square foot. And the guy who had the church before we got it, he gutted the altar, all the marble and all the glass, all the walnut trim and stuff. He picked all the low hanging fruit.
Sure,
and,
yeah.
And so
that's
most of the fruit all the way low hanging.
Yeah,
the windows are not low.
Yeah.
But you got the structure.
Yeah, money.
You replace some of it with plexiglass, and the other side of the building that doesn't get the sun, just replace with just boarded it up.
And a lot of them got there's like the really nice stained glass, the Munich pictorial. Then there's this other kind of screen printed glass. We still got quite a bit of that. It's less expensive, so that's probably why I didn't steal it. But we got a bit of that, just like kids threw rocks through it, you know, like 50 years ago or whatever. So we still have some intact windows, but a lot of them have got holes.
Does that clock tower still work?
I mean, it's there. There's no clock in it.
The bell was taken out like 60s, and they put in the like loudspeakers, like more of the modern churches did.
Oh,
it used to have a big spire.
There used to be like another like it was 80 foot tall copper tower, like the spire on top.
Sandstone.
Okay. Yeah. Wow.
They took it down. They took the bell down. This in the mid 60s, I think.
Sandstone.
A lot of the decorative on the outside of the church is sandstone.
Yeah.
So that doesn't erode.
It does.
That's why I took it down. Yeah, I think they're like,
that's really heavy too.
And they're like, we'll all be dead by the time this ass starts to erode.
Well,
they were.
Whatever the end goal really is, is there like a budget in place? Like, how much money are we talking? I know
$4 million.
How much? Four.
Four sure. million.
I know that earlier you said a million, but really to get it to where it was like the spot,
$1 million will get us to where we can have our occupancy permit open for the main floor with the skate park in it,
right?
Legitimately, with
and
like
the,
four
and
three
the rectory,
four people.
And the rectory,
and then 4 million will get us to where the whole building, the basement, everything else is up to code.
So kind of like that sort of goes into that goes into like the nonprofit we started at Lewis. Like kind of our whole plan for that is like working with underserved youth, and so like basically, you know, a lot of kids like in St. Louis and all over the place, quite frankly, like, you know, there's no like lack of talent and aptitude. There's just like a lack of opportunity. Like, you don't find out that you are really amazing artists. You never get to do any art because you just spend every day trying to survive in your fucking neighborhood. You know, there's this massive loss of creative potential. And so like a lot of the skate park and a lot of things are sort of like the tip of the spear. Like, we talk to people all the time that work with different art centers and youth centers, and they all tell us the same shit. They all say the hardest thing they have to do is just get kids in the door and make them feel engaged. And if you talk to those kids and you're like, how can we want to go to that place and like be engaged? They're always like, that place is fucking lame, bro. I don't want to go there.
Yeah.
But like, we don't have that problem. Like, they beat the door down to come here. And so that's kind of the reason. And then when you get them in, like, that's like half the battle. Then you can actually make a real impact on young kids' lives. And like, that's what the basement is planned out for. That's where like recording studios, wood shops, metal shops, you know, printmaking, things like that are all going to go, so that, you know, you can, you know, figure out what you even are passionate about to pursue it. Cause like, you know, if you're really into whatever it is, silk screening, and like all your boys break your balls, like, you're not going to fucking do it. Like, it's not worth the cost you have to pay to do it. Well, but if you have a place that nurtures your creativity and
like a lot of lower income areas that lack anything that,
yeah, there's nothing. There's no.
Their parents are working all the time, just trying to get, you know, get by with rent and stuff. So they just don't have the money to be able to, you know, facilitate any of that stuff.
Yeah.
And so, and that's unfortunate. Like, you know, obviously from our society, whatever. That's another part of the thing, though. Like Dave Spearhead, the side thing they have going in here, which is also an art gallery, graffiti art gallery. So it's like, you know, he's got this whole thing going where we're going to be putting up like big sheets of masonite and stuff so that people can use like a rotating art, you know, who can come through, they can paint stuff.
Like a big square box or something.
Just all the walls will be covered with it, so I can just replace it whenever somebody else comes in. So that way, because I mean, we've got like a whole inch thick of paint on the walls already. Because
this room's like a square foot smaller because of how many layers of paint I put on the walls.
Right.
And I've buffed some incredible fucking art by like some straight like heavy hitters.
Yeah, well, that's where we finally got the idea of, hey, we should just start putting up something over the wall and then they can paint on the wall still, and then we can take it down. So we don't lose the amazing artwork.
If we walk you around in a tour, like, I mean, we've got like right here, I got shit by Ross Terms from Oakland and Depot. We got the homie from Belgium. We've got a ton of people. I can just rattle off all these graffiti writers, but like at the end of the day, like we have 55 foot ceilings. And so what we basically are planning to do is like a Salon style gallery, like about 26 feet up to the column caps. We'll do plywood with drywall on top, and we'll still paint the walls and buff it, because that like disposable part of graffiti that like it's not forever and permanent is a big part. But we want to be able to actually put like large sheets up and have artists paint those, and then we can sell it to raise money for the organization and also for the artists, so that we can offer, because like it's a pretty specific crowd that like goes gallery hopping, like, you know. Yeah. And it's got a pretty like pinkies up sort of a feel to it that I think turns a lot of people off. But if you have like a dope space that people want to go to, and you have interesting, affordable art that people like, I think people where they are. We have an art show, which is, we're not doing big events here right now, at Kranzberg Art Foundation on the 25th to the 20th of February, the 25th of March, where we have almost 50 4x8 panels done by artists from all over the country. We have a partnership with Paint Lewis. It's ran by my buddies, John Harrington and Brian Walsh and some other cats. So we've been an after party for Paint Lewis for like, what, 7 or 8 years now?
Yeah, so like every year after, you know, in the evening, after one of the days, a bunch of people come over here.
Invite
like
only.
Like invite only type of thing. So some of the best artists in the world come through.
But every year, man, we like, there'd be some great stuff, and we just pull that paint sprayer out, just and sometimes, man, it was like, man, I don't want to buff this piece. But like, you know, like, but you know, out with the old and with the new, nothing in the church is sacred. And so we buff them, but now we're trying to figure out a way to be able to, you know, operate more like a gallery.
Well, like Dave said too, that we could say, you know, split the profit with the artists.
Of course.
You can run it, you can hang up in here for a while, so that way people get pictures of it, stuff in the church actually, and then, you know, maybe the artist makes a little bit of money on it too.
The whole point is to support and create young, you know, support and create young artists. You know, like every day is a vacation if you love your occupation. You know, if you get to do what you love to do for a living, you never work a day in your life. And like the more people that you can help like find their passion and help them to be able to pursue it, like the better of a world like we all live in. Like it's not being able to, it's not just like a loss for that person. It's like a loss for like everybody, like all of us that get to like enjoy, you know, what that person was put on this planet to do.
The whole, everything about it, the giving a place for people to hang out when, what? I mean, I didn't have a place to hang out, so I fucking stole cars. Like, you know, like, I didn't.
That's the other part of, like, you know, when you're a kid, especially if your parents are working all the time and shit, you got plenty of time. I know that's how it was for me. You know, I was raised by a single mom and shit, so it was like, there's plenty of time where I could just go do whatever the fuck I wanted. You know what I mean? It was like throwing shit off the side of the highway bridge. You know, just, we were like, I mean, I was a kid from the 80s. So like, shit was way rougher back then than it is now. You know what I mean? Like, you're definitely bullying people, you know, just a regular, you know, in the inner city fucking around type shit.
Well, I think this, Bedwell, so you can talk too about like, I think really well about like the role, like the importance that skateboarding has on like youth culture, like building determination.
Yeah,
and, like,
it's like $120 gets you your buy-in, and there's no like team fees or like uniform crap or like, you know, you don't gotta pay for like a season. And then, you know, you can just go out in front of your house if there's some concrete there.
You don't even need a friend.
It's
all by yourself. You have a coach, there ain't no nothing. It's just there, you know.
An age, race, creed, gender, none of those things matter. Yeah. You know,
you can either kickflip or you can't, you know what I mean? Like, so
you have rich parents buy you the best gear, it doesn't mean anything. You'd be like a poor kid with a hand-me-down board and you own the skate park because you got more heart than everybody else.
Yeah.
You
know?
Yeah, and it's very individual. Like, you have to learn how to do shit on your own and work at that. But it's also not necessarily isolating. Like it's something that you actually want to find other skaters and figure out shit together.
It's community based,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah,
individual pursuit, but a community sport.
Yes, absolutely. It's the best. My timer's got about 5 more minutes. I want to hit a couple of staples that we do in the show before we that timer goes off. Should we do the Dibs first, or should we do?
Yeah, I like Mr. Dibs. I remember I used to listen to his, like, was like 30 Days album back in the early 2000s, I think.
Well, yeah. All right, let's get a.
Here it goes.
Yeah, let's hear it.
Give it up, Mr. Dibs on the turntable.
Listen to more of this.
Well, hello, gentlemen of the Skate Church. Allow me to quote scripture here. From the book of Walter, chapter 3, verse 7. And the Lord came forth and said unto them, he said, Jim, allow these motherfuckers to go forth and skate. And so it shall be. So there's that. Now, on to the question. Well, first, let me explain something to you. When you're watching a skate video, you have a video with a soundtrack, and then you have videos with a score. A soundtrack is when you get your buddy Hessian Larry and Vagabond Moon Blister, who skate for your team, to pick songs that they think they would look good skating to. Wrong. And then a score is like the mood music in a movie, the background music that pushes the movie or video along. A lot of cats will be like, I'm going to get my homie Little Pickles. He makes beats. Wrong also. You want a proper score for your video, you got to get the proper person to make said score. So the question for you today is, who do you get to score your new video? You have 3 choices. Pick one and explain why. Here are your choices. Choice number 1, Mr. Dibs. Choice number 2, Mr. Fucking Dibs. Pretty decent. Or choice number 3, Mr. Dibs, motherfucker. Now pick one and explain why.
Uh-oh, we might have frozen. Are you frozen?
What?
No. Oh, no, okay.
Hello.
Bacon, bacon, bacon.
Okay, so who do you have make your skate video?
There was a 3rd one.
Mr. Motherfucking Dibs.
Yeah, it was the 3rd.
Mr. Dibs, motherfucker.
We need a hard-hitting soundtrack for this shit, so, you know.
Mr. Dibs, motherfucker.
So, yeah, we want like Sam Jackson, you know, like
yes, yes.
Like, you're going to get punched in the mouth, and his, you know, wallet says bad motherfucker on it.
That's right. You, was it with Mr. Dibs that it was with Dose One, and he had said, this generation is a never been punched in the fucking face generation.
I bet those guys.
Some of them.
Here's a couple of useless facts that I like to use. Okay, here I'm gonna give you guys 5 of them. They're quick and they're skateboarding themed. Okay. Skateboarding was banned in Norway for 11 years. Skateboards were almost used as military gear.
Do that one.
Insurance played a major role in the 1980s dip of skateboarding. Skateboarding is considered to be one of today's top 10 sports, and there are less than 500 skate parks in the U.S. Those are the...
Not for long, right? Not for long.
Get those contracts going.
I wanted to ask... Are you guys, so now that you're official, because I know when we were working on our building, I mostly was working under the radar, because then once you start, you get there, you know, there's a lot of regulations about what you can have space wise and everything. Now that's where you guys are at, where you're now, the city knows you exist. The city knows, you know, you got to have certain things, certain amount of lights for certain things and all that. But what I'm wondering is, so does that, is our events now eliminated until you get up to code, or
we can do like some of even a little bit of private stuff here, sure, and there, but nothing that's like doors wide open. And like, you know, most of our stuff we're trying to do is focus on getting the building in good shape.
Yeah, we just
to get to that point anyway. So we're doing like I said, it's like a, you know, volunteer day that turns into like kind of a skate session hangout, like well, with DJ on the volunteer day, you know, stuff like that. So it's, yeah,
and we let you know, like the big parties and events were always like a means to an end. Like, it was a really fun means to an end, and we certainly enjoyed it. But like, it, you know, the goal was always to save the building.
It was very stressful a lot of the time.
Yeah, you know, throwing, know, and like it's, you know, having 800 people in the basement of abandoned buildings on a rave that, you know, we don't, you know,
we have lots of money and lots of, you know, alcohol or whatever else, and people being all drunk and you have to deal with whatever. It's a lot of shit.
Yeah, yeah. A full lot of kids have never been punched in the face.
Yeah, a whole lot of those.
800 of them.
Well, I do want to ask this though. Is there any, are you guys getting any pushback from anyone?
I mean, so far, I'll be honest, the attitude we've got from the city of St. Louis is for the most part been like, how can we help you do this?
Yeah.
Like they've been really cool, which is weird for me because I've always like kind of viewed them with like a side eye, like they're
well, they got a lot of newer and younger inspectors and stuff these days, and there's a lot of things that, like, you know, Bob Castle did at the City Museum was paved the way for us,
yeah,
by all of the different things that they got to fly. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, like, there's a bunch of codes, like that are because of the museum, like how to code build a treehouse inside of a building and like all sorts of weird shit. Like, and so I think
kind of paved the way for us.
Yeah, for sure.
It's always best to be more knowledgeable than the inspector.
Oh yeah, well that's the thing too, like at this point with my contracting company too, like Dave's the same thing, we both know a lot of the inspectors already from other things too, and so, you know, you start to build a rapport with them, they see what you're doing is like we're not like giant freaking corporations and shit, you sure. know that's who they're really for.
We want to kind of provide all this stuff we're doing to everybody. Like, we don't want to be like a crazy underground like party venue anymore. Like, we did that for 10 years and we did it to save the building, but like, you know, eventually it kind of got to the point where like we formed that nonprofit in 2016, and so like we this has always kind of been our goal was to do this, and we kind of just sort of bit the bullet and we're just like, let's just be a legit organization, because I think as far as like media, we kept everything on the low for a long time.
Yeah.
Because I think every media organization did me or Bedwell up like 20 times, you know, and we did Vice.
Yeah, we were telling yeah. like we were saying we're not doing media, yeah.
Basically. Like, we did Vice News, and we did an HBO show, Betty, but like, we like, yo, like,
well, I used to say, like, in the local news, we don't want to be in the local news because there's a great chance, like, Inspector, yeah. Somebody's gonna see it, but if we're on like Vice or something,
yeah, exactly. You know, Inspector don't watch Vice News, but they watch the fucking 6 o'clock news. So
that's right.
But like, it was cool though, because there was actually like a real benefit to that, because you can kind of stay in this like underground world sort of forever. Like, we've been on the front page of Reddit a couple times, and I always enjoy reading the comments where people are like, that place is in Germany, no, it's in Detroit, no, it's my dad owns that place. I was like, oh, we don't know any of these people, but like, that's cool. Like, I remember when we went up to the X Games with our homie Zach Ward, who built that vert ramp back there. And like, we were at we crashed like their ESPN media party, and we're hanging out, we're like basically like brought a bunch of food, and we're like without asking the caterers, and like we're doing a bunch of shit, and like
he didn't bring a bunch of food, he smoked two pigs,
yeah, we roasted a hog,
he roasted a whole hog. Yeah.
We brought our homies that brought like,
handing out, like,
to a catered event.
We showed up like, hey, you want some fucking meat?
Well, it's like all the like big wig like reporters and stuff from all the different places, and then all like the biggest athletes that were going to be in the
X-Men. I was talking to
what was that? Or whatever.
Yeah, what was that chick's name? I was talking to the chick there, and like she's like a little blonde skateboarder from Brazil. She's like so attractive. Yeah. They made her in a laboratory.
Leticia.
Yeah. Buffoni. So we were talking to her, and
six gigantic freaking Brazilian dudes standing around like about bouncers.
But she was like, what is Sk8 Liborius? Because she was on our shirts, and I was like, oh, we pull it up on a phone. She's like, oh, that's you. This is you. Like, people know about it, but they don't know like what it is or where it is or who it is or like why, what's going on. And that shit was on purpose, because we wanted to do this mission for like, you know, kind of like youth for our neighborhood and our city.
How hard it was to find an Airbnb that roasts a pig in the backyard.
We found it though. Shout out to you, Airbnb guy. Sorry about the goose stains on your driveway.
And on a lower level, like, are there, for the lack of better word, like, care, like, is there like a neighborhood Karen, or like, are there anyone like on the lower level that are like, oh, those tattooed drinking kids hanging out at the
not anymore, like, and that was sort of why we kind of, part of the reason why we were happy to wait on media, because when we, now that we're doing a bunch of press, like we talk about our nonprofit and the work that we're trying, it's not like, cause if you just let it be party skate church, it's just that it's wherever the fucking internet says it is forever. And then that's who you are. And so we wanted to control the narrative and be like, this is why we're doing this with this church. We're doing it to help, you know, like underserved urban youth is the congregation here now. Like that's what we're doing with this place.
Well, it's like Dave said earlier, it's the party stuff was kind of a mean to it. It was fun and whatever, but like, you know, just to get us to a certain hump.
Yeah. We'll do it again. But
well,
like,
and there are people with deep pockets that love to put money into stuff like what you're doing. They don't want to put
Introduce them to our way.
Yeah. Well, I was just going to say, so a friend of mine runs a nonprofit here in Salt Lake City, because we also have a place in Salt Lake City. That's where we're at currently. We're not at our Hannibal house. But he runs a place called Spy Hop, and what's his name?
Bezos.
When Bezos' wife divorced him, she took $34 million, and put $1 million into 34 different companies secretly, like kind of reached out to the companies, and his was
nonprofit.
Nonprofit companies. So she took, she picked 34 companies, I think it was 34 or 32, all over the US, and gave them each $1 million, and gave them $1 million. Not for, you know, it was part of the divorce money she had, but it was like kind of like on the low, on the DL, and then she gave them companies. So now my friend's nonprofit that they run, it's a youth organization for media, for like kids to learn how to make music
and
make
media.
Movies, make cartoons, all that. Gave them $1 million, and now it's a free, the fucking venue is incredible. Now, I'm not saying I've got any sort of connections that can make that happen, but my goal with doing the episode with you guys is to reach out to the people that I do have connection with, who has other connections that have connections down the line. I'm nowhere near anywhere connections like that, but I would love to be.
Well, we appreciate any connection at all.
We'll take $20.
Yeah.
I would just love to be able to get this into the to the eyes of those people, and I like. I'm
that kind of GoFundMe. You can talk to us directly too. So
yeah, we have a GoFundMe that they can donate to. And we also, if someone does want to make a large donation, they can email us at just skatelaborious@gmail.com. We can send out from our nonprofit like a tax letter and stuff for a write-off. Because you know, I would figure with Mrs. Bezos, I bet she sat with her accountant, like, Ms. Bezos, you have a $34 million tax burden this year. She's like, well, it looks like we're giving $34 million away.
Yeah. Well, and that's what I'm saying. And I think I'm the party. I'm of the, like, I like underground party and all that shit. But when it comes to like, when you need money, shit costs money, and that can only last you so long. So I agree with you guys. Like, you do have to eventually be like, okay, now let's, you know, if we want this to continue, we need to get.
That's the phase right now. We've got a bunch of people on our side, a bunch of, you know, super professional nonprofit type people that have been helping us out. We've got marketing people. We got a really nice video that, you know, they put together for us on the GoFundMe. You know, we're just trying to get to that point of where we can help the community out more.
Yeah, I don't know. I just want to see this. Again, I like to do nice things for people, but I'm also selfish. Like, I want to see that place fucking be the joint, because I want to come. I want to come down there whenever we're in St. Louis. Like, I want to be there.
Well, like our gallery thing starting too. We're doing this really cool fundraiser with that whole situation too. Like Dave was mentioning earlier, with the Kranzberg Art Foundation, which is a big, huge, amazing nonprofit here in St. Louis. Also, so
I do love the walk around idea. One of my favorite things to do when we go to Chicago is just go look, just hang out on the bridge over the skate park and just watch people.
The Grant skate park.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, Grant Park.
Yeah. And I can just see the same thing happening there around the church.
Oh, yeah.
And we want to do a bunch of different stuff, too. So, like, we've done drone races, we've done parties, we've done aerial silk telling out of the ceiling. And so, there's a lot of, like, communities that, you know, we talk about doing rock climbing wall up inside of the tower. Like, there's a lot of communities
that. We've done yoga classes,
whatever.
We've done pop-up
movement classes, like
private. We've done like big dinners. We've done pop-up like craft markets and like a bunch of different stuff. And so like between the two buildings, we've got like 50,000 square feet within the basement upstairs. Yeah. So we want a home for like all these different creative communities that don't necessarily have one. I need
a big space.
If you are able to run a bi-monthly makers market where people who like you know, make dope shit in their garage, you know, like crafts and stuff. And so, you know, like you can support a ton of people that way. And those are popping up all over the place. There's the punk rock flea market in St. Louis. Yeah, really
we had like Can of Weed last year, where it's like the cannabis
industry
people,
folks.
Yeah, they just like an industry type of thing.
Oh, shit.
Like,
yeah, wait.
Edibles at home.
Well, before we wrap it up, I do want to hit a couple of real quick technical questions that I was curious about. How are the city taxes for the building covered? Is it just that because it's nonprofit, that's a little easier?
They're not that bad. Like, you know, they're pretty, I mean, we just paid them out of pocket for years and years.
It's like right around $2,000 just for the personal property tax.
Oh, cool.
That's not bad.
That's not bad at all. I think that's what we're paying.
Especially for 50,000 square feet.
Based on building value. And this building was like probably negative value in the eyes of the city.
But that's something that will come up, though, when it does, as soon as the improvements come up. That,
but with it being a nonprofit, they'll be fine.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Yeah. Okay. And then do you guys have like regular skate sessions? The people come in
we're technically closed, so like we do these volunteer type sessions, and we also have a couple what we call key holders. They're just standing people in the community that kind of help us out a lot, and then they're able to have a key, so they come and skate and bring their friends and stuff sometimes.
Yeah, and folks like kids that are that we want to sponsor, because we don't have any money to sponsor anybody, but if there's a kid who's coming up that's really dope, we'll give him a key to the place. But, like, now you have your own private skate park. Like, that's how we sponsor
that's
you.
Awesome.
That's a good idea.
But, so we'll do private sessions. Like, people hit us up if they're coming through town, they want to plan a skate trip. We do those all the time as well. But we used to do like 3 sessions a week, but we kind of did that just to blow our Instagram up, because we had to launch a fundraiser, and ain't nobody giving a shit about our like 8,000 followers at that time. We don't have the platform to launch a fundraiser from, so we really started like pumping skate sessions.
I mean, you know, I've been in the skateboarding industry for a long time, and like, I used to go to skateboard shops and stuff like that. And like, you can't really make that much money like on skateboarding. You know what I mean? Like,
oh, yeah.
Like, for love.
Yeah, you can't go asking a whole bunch of little skaters for money.
No.
You get it from their parents. the way we make most of the more of the money in our sessions is if we have like concessions. You know what I mean? Like, you sell pack to them, and you do off the door pretty much. You know what I mean?
If any of your listeners and stuff, if they want to come through, you know, just like shoot us a DM on Instagram.
Yeah,
and so
Facebook
like
too, yeah.
And Facebook. And we'll basically, you know, we set up private session.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that is awesome. That's what we're going to direct everybody. So you're saying the best place to get a hold of or to if they want to put in money, or if they want to give money to the, is it a GoFundMe you said?
Yeah, there's a link in the link tree on our Instagram. And the best way to contact us is probably DM on Instagram.
Okay. And that's the Skate Sk8 Liborius. Okay.
Yep.
Well, yeah, you guys, it was awesome to chat with you. Before we end, is there any final thought that you want to that you didn't get to that you want to put out there that's specific?
We went through it. I
give
mean,
us money.
Yeah, help us. Like, a lot of people. A lot of people are like,
keep this thing going.
And they're like, oh yeah, I really love what you guys are doing. I really hope you pull it off. Like, well, like, fucking help us then. Yeah.
Well,
like,
that's one of the things. This is like, you know, we're trying to do this for the love. Both of us have our own things going on. You know,
so families,
Frenchie, and whatever.
Yeah, you got a farm.
So, like, we're not hurting. You know what I mean? Like, we're just trying to make this an amazing thing. You know, we've been coming out. We've came out of pocket a lot for it, just to keep it.
Yeah, I mean,
and so it's just at that point of let's make this for everybody, so let's everybody get it and thumbs up.
None of us like make any money at all off this. It's just like a black hole for our time and any extra money that we have for the last 11 years. Like, it's all just, you know, to try and, you know, leave the world better than we found it. You know, like, do something
passion
dope.
Project.
Yeah, do something dope, you know?
Yeah, our passion project. But passion projects need to be funded. So all you people out there, even though these guys are doing it passionately,
go throw them. $10, even $10, $20.
$10 does go.
At least buy a bag of mortar.
Yeah,
it helps. That's how we got here. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're all capable. And that was another reason why we were able to succeed as much as we have. It's because a lot of us have done this type of work and remodeling stuff, and, you know, it's whatever, a different type of
skills.
If we do it all on our own, it's a lot cheaper. You know, labor is a large portion of what, you know, construction costs.
And it adds up, man. Like, I mean, we've so far to that $1 million of occupancy, we've raised about $100,000. And that's in like $5, $20, $50, $100, $1,000 donations. Like, I mean, I think it's, you know,
I mean, that's what the politicians do. They're always emailing you and saying, and you give me $5, give me $10. And they get these huge campaigns. Yeah. So, yeah, well, and why also, not a skate park?
You said $10. It used to be you could buy 5 2x4s with $10, but now you can only get one.
Yeah, and the good old
days. I can get two with $10. The good old days, like 3 years ago.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Oh, I love what you guys are doing over there. I'm a huge fan of it. I can't wait to see it in person. We'll be back in Hannibal in
next month.
So yeah, and if I can, we'll work that out after we're done recording here. But yeah, it was awesome to talk with you guys. And you know, I'll do my best to try to get eyes.
Yeah,
on
we'll
space.
Spread the word.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be awesome. If you could share our links and stuff like that, that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
And this is such a, like, even for someone like me, just a mom, like, I grew up trying to skate. I could never really do much, but I loved having the skateboard in my hand. I felt safe. I felt secure with it because it could be a weapon if I wasn't trying to ride it and die. And then just the skate culture. And then when that comes with music and it comes with art, and there's so much surrounding every aspect of it. That it's just this project. And then, like Ty was saying, he and I have been restoring some houses up in Missouri and Hannibal. And so just everything that you're doing, it just hits us, I think, like probably everybody. But it's just such a great thing. And I'm so, like, proud of you guys for sticking with it and doing it. It's amazing.
It is really amazing. Yeah, I grew up in a my dad was a brick mason, so I was a hod tender for many years and did a lot of construction. And so I also would like to come to volunteer days. You know, I enjoy drinking and I enjoy working, so
drinking, working, shooting, skating, art.
I enjoy drinking, skating, working, and
shooting
and all those things. So
milking cows.
It's a perfect fit.
Okay, we're real good buddies.
Yeah, we'll be fast friends. Yeah,
absolutely.
Well, you guys can come out at the church, and then we'll go out to the farm, and we'll barbecue and shoot a whole bunch of guns.
I'm all for it. No, truthfully, I'm all into it. So, yeah, you guys, congratulations on that, and also here's to continued success, and hopefully more money starts filling in there to make this a thing that everybody can experience. So,
hey, thanks guys. I appreciate y'all having us on.
Yeah, of course. We'll talk soon, all right?
All right, get at us.
Thanks.
All right. Peace.
Bye. Bye.
Yeah, I don't. It's hard. Yeah, you know, inside big open spaces.
Echoey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll do what I can.
But it's perfect because you wouldn't understand what they were saying outside of that.
Yeah, you know, no, they had to do it. Yeah. I'm glad that they were in there and did it because, yeah, I don't know. I get so into things. You know, I said it the first of the episode.
Well, I loved it too. Even when you said, "Hey, come down here and check this out." And you showed me that video. You were watching that video.
Where was I at? Were we
just
in Hannibal?
No, we were just here in the basement. It was just a minute ago. But yeah, I was just like, that's it. That's perfect.
It's everything you're right. I'm glad you said that at the end there because it is. It's everything that we're about. Those old churches.
And not only that, and like, I know that under like inner city kids and stuff, they certainly need a place to go. But I think all kids need a place. And these types of kids, like, who are into skating, who are into music, who are into arts, they need a place to communicate with others that's not YouTube, that is not on the phone, you know? You just need to be around those people. So it's just really, it's a great thing for all youth.
And last night, we went to an event. We went to a music, it's like a music school. I don't know what will end up being said here, so I won't name the company, but it was this really cool event, black tie event, at a really amazing theater, like where we saw Hamilton, like it's a real deal, and it was sold out, and it was these kids that go to music school. It's kind of like a School of Rock thing, and it was their performance. all these different people, and like they had the drummer from Journey and the saxophonist from the Saturday Night Live band and the original creator of the Blues Brothers band, Tony Bones, like they had all these people. Big Bad Voodoo Daddy performed. Like these people were mentors to these students. And it was a great concert and fucking really great musicians, and they're doing all these great things. But I could not help but feel while we were there watching, experiencing this beautiful music and all this greatness, and Donny Osmond's, or the youngest Osmond, was, yeah, the youngest Osmond was the MC. Host, the MC mm-hmm. of the event. Felt very much, you know, it was cool. It was a really great event, but I couldn't help but feel like, oh, this is
what one of those kids get.
Privilege. This is one of those events, those things that privileged kids get.
But it seemed like there were a couple.
There were
kids there that was helping. So.
Yeah, and I'm not a woke fucking an asshole or whatever. You know, we were not, but I couldn't help but feel that way. But it was great. It was an awesome event, and good for them kids, because I am, you know, for kids being part of music. But I did have that feeling of like, man. Is Spy Hop on the other end of that? Is that kind of...
Well, Spy Hop used to have to charge. They places did. Have
That's
to
true.
Charge.
That's
you
true.
Know, when no, you're get getting... You got to do what you got to do to stay afloat. Because you know when you work
things cost money.
At Spy Hop, there were kids that they had money and they hired you to do like special things.
But they also had kids. They also were taking... kids who couldn't
right
fund.
That's true. Yep.
It was a but then maybe the other place does that. I was just thinking this Sk8 Liborius is that
it's that kind of creative space where you can use your body and your mind and your hands and your everything,
a place,
and you can be a part of building it or
yeah,
helping
that's
it
the
become
coolest.
Built like he said, everyone can carry a bucket.
Yeah, they have those volunteer days. I thought that was like one of the coolest things.
No, I think we definitely should go volunteer.
Yeah, we'll go. Oh, absolutely. Hell yeah. You
and
know
then
me.
We can
I
go
love
to Costco
to
after. Stock up.
One other quick thing too. So I obviously you can tell how much we love this whole Sk8 Liborius thing. I was going to say this at the before the episode, or you know, in the intro. I love everything about this whole Sk8 Liborius thing. I love everything about it. I love it. Fucking love it. But I did want to say there's something similar. You know, I love giving to things like this. A community thing and for the kids and all of that. But there something I get turned off a little bit. Maybe this is what was happening last night at that event that we were talking about. And I can kind of liken it to When we're at a funeral, I love when people start telling their personal stories about the person that's dead. It feels very real. And then all of a sudden they start getting religious and talking about things that feel a little mushy and it feels artificial. I sort of get that way with things like charitable givings and stuff. Like I said, I love doing things for the...
there are a lot of charities that just like... skim the surface of the money given, and then the rest of the money goes to whoever's running the charity. Well, so it's good to be cautious with where you're.
Well, sometimes it gets artificial when they're like, "Oh, it's all about the kid," or you know, like it starts to sound a little phony, instead of like, "Hey, I don't."
Well, and this is St. Louis. This isn't. I mean, there are suburbs in St. Louis, but St. Louis has a good amount of grit.
Yeah. It
and
does.
There's a lot of inner city, and there's a lot. There's there. St. Louis, I mean, we've been living in Missouri for 10 years, and we always see something different and something new in a new neighborhood.
Yeah,
it's
Louis
just
is a cool
like.
City.
It's amazing. Yeah. It's a great city. Actually, it's one where I think I would consider living.
Yeah.
It's a great city, but no, I get what you're saying. It's the real deal.
It is the real deal. Sk8 Liborius is the real deal. And. I was being honest about we don't have the connections to
no,
we don't have direct connections, but we do have friends that have, you know, we'll
friends
do what we can.
People.
Yeah,
for sure.
We'll do what we can. I'd love to see that happen. I'm gonna wish I edited out what I was saying at the first of the episode.
You want to just re-record the
about
beginning?
The gratitude and all that, but we keep it real here, so we'll just let it. we'll just let it ride. I want to just see if there was something else that I wanted to say in the beginning that I just didn't get to. Because I have some stuff that I could save for another episode. I know. I guess that's it. Was it sounding like cheesy that I was like giving gratitude to these people or braggy? I wasn't braggy at all. I just want them to know that I appreciate them.
I'm sure
without
they know
it singing.
But
singing.
I don't think you need to necessarily say it here.
I don't have to. Yeah, you're right. Huh. I don't want to reshoot the intro because then it's not real.
I just said those people on Instagram. Here's my 10 days of gratitude.
I know. I hated the whole gratitude hikes and all that.
Oh, that's what you were saying. Mm-hmm. You were saying something about Oprah gratitude.
Yeah. You know, I was bumming out today because Hera canceled and she was like, I don't even know if I want to. Yeah, she was like, she goes, oh, sorry. I have. She sent like 4 messages, said, I'm sorry. And then sent another one. I can't do the interview. She is German too, so
right.
Or French, so maybe it's
right.
A translation thing. But then it was like, I don't, I'm not feeling well. And then I said, well, do you want to reschedule, or do you just not want to do it at all? She said maybe something later in the year, or she said maybe we can do something later in the year. And so as she was sending that, I sent something. Do you not want to do it at all? Which is fine. Or do you want to reschedule? And she said, well, I don't want to decide now.
Yeah, that's okay. She's not feeling well.
Yeah, no, and it's fine, but it bummed me out. You know, it just bummed me out. But at the same time, we got someone who I'm excited to have on the show. So, okay. Well,
that's okay.
That's what was bumming
people,
me out.
You
know.
You never know what people are going through.
Exactly.
Not, so.
But it still bummed me out because I was like, oh, shit, I was really looking forward to that.
And we'll get to talk to her at some point.
Hopefully.
You're a big fan of her work. In fact,
I wanted to send her a picture. I own you. No.
She's like, oh, I remember you. Nope.
Oh, you know what? I was going to say real quick before, and then we'll wrap it up. There was that thing where you were saying about the superstar syndrome or something like that.
Oh my gosh. I was just kidding. I just
I know
that
you
up.
Were, but I do want to just say.
Yes.
I know how what I think what happens to me is I know how hard I work and how hard I grind and to get the things that I want, you know. Mm-hmm. We work fucking hard. Really hard. Mm-hmm. Doesn't seem like it, but we do. It's like constant work. I think what happens to me is I know people who are like way more talented than me, who have way better or just are,
and it seems like they're not working.
And they don't, and they're not, they don't do anything. They're not doing anything within it. Drives me fucking bonkers. Mm-hmm. And I always want to like try to be like, oh, you know, just work harder, do this. And they don't. And so I see them not reaching their fullest potential.
Are we talking about me here?
No.
And my
no.
Super walking?
No. But you know what I'm saying, right? There are people that are incredible, and they're just, I want to just like fucking push them and be like, come on, just take some work. Just
nothing you can do about
there's
it.
Not,
they're
but,
living their own life.
But that's what I start getting in that mode when I'm like, I work hard.
You do work hard.
And so I'm like, and what we've got from that is a good life. Not just me working. You know, it's not just me. We make a perfect team. All right, that's it.
Go away.
Thanks. Thanks, everybody, for listening. At DOD45W, ArtByTai.com, DOD45.com.
Skate Laborious.
Skate Laborious.
.com.
Is that what it is? Mm-hmm. Just yep. With SK8?
Mm-hmm.
Go over there and give them some money. Everyone's got a community space.
I will
like,
do that right now.
Yeah. Well, everyone's got a community thing
on
like
the top
that in their
right
city.
Corner is donate.
Okay.
Gets you right over there.
Hit the donate button. And then if you do have connects to big pocketed individuals that need a tax write-off, just go look at the pictures and the videos, anything about Sk8 Liborius, and you'll be like, holy shit, that's a space that needs to be nurtured and immediately. You know how I get. I'm impatient. Like I want something to happen now because I'm always afraid that I'm gonna die before it happens. So when I saw Sk8 Liborius the first time, I was like, how do we get money to these guys so that they don't die before it, I don't die before I get to go there and experience it at its fullest. All right, everybody, we'll see you next episode, and it's gonna be with Eli.
Ooh.
Yeah.
My nephew.
Not our nephews. We have two Elis in our family of nephews, but no, with Eli from Grouchy Eli. Yeah, E-L-I-G-H. The man. He'll be our next episode. So Thanks for listening. Go support Sk8 Liborius and all of that. You know all the smash smashes and go to theirs and do that. Okay. Thank you, everybody. Have a good night. Cheers.
D-O-D-45.
Thank you for joining in on yet another episode of DOD45. Please hit the subscribe or follow button so that you never miss an episode. You can even go one step further by leaving us a review on Apple Podcasts to help other interesting people like yourself find our podcast. You can find me at ArtByTai on all the socials or at ArtByTai.com. If you'd like to follow this podcast on social media, we are at DOD45W on Instagram, or you can go over to our website, DOD45.com, where you can shoot us an email, join our mailing list, and watch all of our past episodes. Thanks for joining us. Peace.